So I'm going to share this talk with my collaborator Guillermo. Maybe we'll have questions at the very end. So basically, we want to talk about the challenges and opportunities with event-based cameras. Before I start, let me ask you, how many of you here are familiar with event-based cameras? Can you raise your hand? Oh, OK, less than 50%. And how many of you are coming from industry here? Can you raise your hand? Another 50%, good to know. OK, so let me give you our general popular slide about what is an event camera. So an event camera is a novel sensor that measures only motion in the scene. It was first commercialized by Professor Toby Delbruck in my department at the University of DTH Zurich under the name of Dynamic Vision Sensor. That's what the sensor actually looks like today with the smallest aspect ratio, by the way, from Toby Delbruck. So what is special about this sensor is that all the pixels are smart and independent of each other. What does it mean, that they're smart? So each pixel basically reacts only to motion in the scene. So basically, whenever a single pixel detects a change of intensity, it triggers an event, which contains the X and Y coordinates of the pixel triggering the event, the timestamp, as well as the sign of the change, positive or negative. So to try to explain that more clearly, imagine that you have a rotating disk. So the output is not frames, like a standard camera would provide you, but it's rather a stream of asynchronous events in space and time. Does it make sense? So the nice thing about this is that if nothing moves in front of the camera, no events are generated. So you have a drastic reduction in bandwidth. And the other cool thing is that no matter how fast you move the sensor, it doesn't suffer from motion blur, because it's a differential sensor. It's not integrating light over time. Now, because of these key advantages, an event camera has four key features. First of all, a microsecond time resolution, no motion blur, a very high dynamic range, so actually 8 orders of magnitude superior than standard cameras. What does it mean? This is a picture that Toby Delbruck took during the solar eclipse in Europe in 2015. What you see on the top is his hand that was being moved in front of the camera during the solar eclipse. And in the background, you can see actually the moon shape covering the sun, all at the same time without using a black filter. So typically, you wouldn't be able to see simultaneously the hand and the moon or the sun in background with a standard camera. Another cool thing about these event-based cameras is that they have a very low power. So at peak time, actually, the newest one, they consume 10 milliwatts, versus, for example, 1 watt of standard cameras. On average, when actually there is, most of the scenes are usually static. So on average, actually, the consuming power is less than 1 milliwatt. So there is a lot of potential, I would say, here for IoT applications. The problem is that there is no free lunch. So it's not all beautiful, but actually there are challenges, as Andrew Davison just spoke about. So an event camera actually streams an output that is asynchronous. So you have to come up with new algorithms in order to make sense of this strange data. So what me, Guillermo, and the people in my group have been trying to focus on in the past 5 years is trying to find algorithms and ways to actually unlock the capabilities of event cameras to design systems that are high speed, high dynamic range, low latency, while processing millions of events per second. Before I start showing you the applications that we actually did in our lab, I want to say that usually we prototype all our algorithms on both real-world datasets, and we released the event camera dataset a few years ago, as well as more recently also on simulators. So we have used a photorealistic simulator based on Unreal Engine, which is called eSim, Event Camera Simulator, which simulates not only images, but also events from an ideal event camera, including also a Gaussian noise model. We also simulate IMU and motion blur of the images. And we actually use also the simulator now a lot for prototyping algorithms as well as deep learning. So what I'm going to show you next is actually a lot of videos, and I'll try to give you some details. Later, Guillermo will actually speak more clearly about the theory behind. So the first thing that actually I want to show, that was actually a PAMI paper that was published 2 years ago, is that to inspire you that event cameras can actually be beneficial for AR, VR applications. What you're seeing in this video is actually 6 DoF camera tracking from an available prior photometric depth map. So Now, assume you have a dev map on the environment that has been built during a previous mapping stage, for example, from a standard camera. And now you want to enable very high speed and HDR 6TOF tracking using all events. That's what we are doing here. Actually, here we are doing event by event processing. So as soon as an event arrives, we use that event to update the 6TOF pose of the camera. This algorithm, however, is not running in real time, because it needs, it's processing a million of events per second, and actually it will need a GPU to run in real time. What you can see in the bottom left video is comparison against a standard camera. When you start moving, shaking a standard camera, the standard camera, of course, output becomes blurry. And so a standard VO solution would actually break, while a VO solution based on event cameras does not break. So I hope this convinces you that there is an interest in using event cameras for high-speed applications, especially for automotive. A few years ago, we got approached by Siemens and SBB, which is actually the Swiss train company, and they asked us, if we could test our event cameras to improve the speed estimation of trains, of Swiss trains. Apparently, in Switzerland, they are obsessed about punctuality, and they want to have any possible new sensor in order to improve, even a tiny 1%, what they already are capable of doing. So we installed a few event cameras there. What you see here is actually reconstruction from a single event camera that was attached to the side window, observing basically the scene. The train was running at 200 kilometers per hour, so we slowed the motion in order to visualize it here. What you can see here is the output of our algorithm that we actually open sourced a few months ago. It's called EMVS. It's based on an IGCV paper that stands for Event-Based Multi-View Stereo. It's actually very simple and runs in real time, so you can test it if you have an event camera. What I want to point out here is actually that because of the great advantages of event cameras in low light, you can even reconstruct the wall of a tunnel in low light. So the light here is not coming from the train, it's coming actually from the two ends of the tunnel. It's natural light. So that you need still light, but still very small light is enough to actually allow reconstruction with an event camera. Another thing I wanted to talk about is in the last 3 years, so we actually have not sticked only to event cameras alone, but we started looking at combining event cameras with standard cameras in order to improve SLAM and robotics, in scenarios that are usually inaccessible to standard cameras, like high speed and high dynamic range. So a few years ago, Toby Delbrück actually came up with a new sensor called Davis that contains both a standard camera and an event-based camera in the same pixel array. So the same pixels can now both trigger events as well as accumulate photons over time. So you see what the output looks like. The frame cannot be up to 30 years or on demand, while remember that the events are coming continually in time. Now, a cool thing about this sensor is that it can enable tracking, for example, features like corners in the blind time between two frames. Now, how can that be used in practice? Well, it can be used again for AR, VR applications. And I want to show you something that we set up in order to demonstrate the advantages of using an event camera to complement the problems, the issues of standard cameras. The paper is published under the name of Ultimate SLAM, and the idea is to combine frames, events, and an IMU to achieve the ultimate SLAM performance. Ultimate for us means that it's not the last possible thing that you can do, but actually that it can significantly outperform standard camera SLAM in those scenarios that are affected by high speed and the high dynamic range. And we came up with a demo to show that, where basically my PhD student Henri attached an event camera to a leash and is spinning it like a cowboy. What you can see on the top left is the video from a standard camera also attached to the leash. And you can see that it's motion blurred and also overexposed. So the system is not capable of detecting and tracking features there. However, we came up with the algorithms that can extract both features and track them from event camera data. Now, Ultimate SLAM combines frames, events, and IMU. So it's actually agnostic to where the features are coming from, whether frames or whether events or the union of them, because remember, we are using Davis sensors, so actually the event camera and the standard camera share the same frame. And then what we do is that we extract features from both sensors and we feed them to a standard state-of-the-art visual inertial odometry algorithm based on sliding window estimation. That's what the output looks like. So the particle trajectory is actually reconstructed from frames, events, and IMU. In this very specific video, of course, the features are coming only from the event camera. Let me show you instead a video where the features are coming both from the event camera and the standard camera. Here we are using Ultimate SLAM in the loop to control an autonomous drone to follow a circular trajectory in our lab. What you see on the bottom left is the features tracked from a standard camera, in the middle from an event camera. Now the drone is being autonomous already. And now to demonstrate the advantages of an event camera, we switched off the light. And you can see that the standard camera frame turned black. So they were not capable to track any features, while it was possible to do this from the event-based camera. So I hope this convinces you that there is a clear advantage using event cameras to complement standard cameras. Many people ask, can we just rely on event cameras? No, you cannot, because event cameras are basically high-pass sensors. So with no motion, they do not output anything. You still need a standard camera. Now, another thing I wanted to show you is more recent results that we published at ICRA a few weeks ago. The first is an application to robotics, for example, for dynamic obstacle detection and avoidance. What you see here is we are actually throwing balls to a quadrotor, and the quadrotor detects the ball and triggers an evasive maneuver just based on the output of the event camera. Now we show that in slow motion. So in this paper called How Fast is Too Fast, we tried to answer the question, when is an event camera advantageous compared to a standard camera? We show that depending on the relative speed between objects thrown and the quadrotor and the field of view, actually an event camera can allow you to fly twice as fast as with a standard camera. And now, before I pass the word to Guillermo, other things that we will be presenting at CVPR this week. So we also looked at ways, actually, to allow event cameras to reconstruct images, like previous work have done, like Andrew Davison, Matthew Cook, and many others before. So what you see here is actually, on the left, is the output of an event camera. And on the right, you see images reconstructed only from events. So I'm telling you this because many people think that the right image is a standard camera. It's not. It's actually reconstructing only from events. Here specifically, we are using a recurring neural network that is trained only in simulation. It is supervised because in simulation we have ground truth. And we minimize the perception loss. Now, why would we need to do that? So here the paper is investigating what if, so first of all, whether it's possible to render high-quality images, and if you do that, whether you can actually enable, for example, generating high-speed videos without relying on very expensive equipment. What we are showing here on the left is, for example, a Huawei P20 Pro camera that is taking frames at 240 FPS, and on the right, our reconstruction. Look at the action. Here we shoot a bullet from a rifle at 376 meters per second. I show you first the real-time action. You don't see anything, right? It's too fast. Now I show you the rendering done from both the Huawei phone and from the standard camera, and from the event-based camera. The event-based camera is on the right. It allowed us to render frames up to 5,400 FPS. You can see that you can actually see much more, a much higher temporal resolution what is going on, all the pieces getting moved away. Another thing I want to show here is many people ask about potential for automotive. So here, actually, Here in the middle is our reconstruction from an event camera, and on the right there is the output from a standard phone camera. I hope you can see from this video that thanks to the HDR advantages of an event camera, it is possible to always have a clear image, even when you exit from a tunnel, which is usually very difficult for standard cameras. Another thing I wanted to show is for example, what happens if you apply YOLO, so image recognition, to the reconstruction from events? So, of course, it works as good as standard cameras, but now you get all the advantages of event-based cameras in high-speed scenarios and HDR. So you're actually increasing the performance even further. And what I want to show you here instead is mega depth, so monocular depth estimation applied to the output of an event camera. Notice that what I want to say here is not that we should reconstruct images with event cameras and then apply standard computer vision algorithms. I just want to show you that the information from the event camera is there to enable using, for example, applying standard computer vision algorithms. But I think that the future of what the research should be doing is to do end-to-end algorithms that process directly the output of the events and output what you actually want to do for your task. Okay, I hope the message is clear. In conclusion, before I pass the work to Guillermo, I think event cameras have very clear advantages for HDR, high speed and low latency, especially for AR, VR, automotive, drones, and especially for IoT. I think the first killing application will be in IoT. However, there are many open problems. How to optimally process the events for a given task? What about the noise? Because it's not actually Gaussian as you might think, and it's not even regular or uniform over the pixels. How do we do asynchronous learning and inference? How do we optimally combine events with a dedicated hardware? Low latency estimation and control? And how do we optimally tune sensor parameters for a given task? So we didn't address all these points, so I think there is room for a lot of research here. But I will let now Guillermo to talk about the first point, how to process the events.
Thank you very much, Davide. Okay, so as we have seen, there are some open problems, and I just want to talk very briefly about this one that especially attracts my interest. There are many other things that we could talk about, but I just want to talk about this question, how to process events, how to maybe optimally process events. And here there are two schools. One is the school that we've seen before, and Andrew Davison presented, trying to process event by event, and another one is trying to process events in groups. So on the top right, you can see kind of this distinction, processing one event, almost one event at a time, or processing groups of events. And so both have advantages and disadvantages. So event by event processing has the advantage that you can go very low latency with it, in principle down to microseconds. But the problem is that, as we said, millions of events may be generated, and to process all this amount of information, you need distributed hardware or GPUs to be very, very fast, keep up with real time. On the other hand, in the event packet processing paradigm, which means you process the last n events, you will not have this low latency because you have to wait for those events, but sometimes it's not needed. You don't need this microsecond resolution. And in these videos, let me show the kind of two sample examples for the application of SLAM in these two paradigms. On the right, you see the event by event paradigm, sixth of SLAM, and on the left you see event packet paradigm, which is some work that we did in the lab. And both are valid solutions. Both achieve real-time sixth of tracking and mapping. They are just different solutions. We're just scratching the surface of how to do SLAM with this. So let me talk about this way of processing events that we've been working on for the last year. So I mean, some people like to use spiking neural networks, some people like to use deep learning and regular networks. We would like to talk about these paradigms, which is called motion estimation by focus maximization. And here, the setup is the following. Imagine you have the set of events in a space-time volume. You don't know anything about the past, so just focus on this group of events in a space-time volume. You see x, y, and time. This is time. And these red and blue dots are nothing more than just the individual events that are triggered as the edge moves on the image plane. And they are brightness increase or brightness decrease. And the main idea is that if we see it here, the information is not very intelligible. But if we kind of look at this volume from a different view, which in this case is just one way of speaking, I just want to say that we will try to come up with some candidate point trajectories on the image plane and count how many events are along those trajectories. So we are just counting events. And if we do this count, and we propose nice candidate trajectories, we will end up with the information being much more intelligible. We'll come up with this image that we want to maximize its sharpness. So that's what we call by trying to maximize the focus of the image. So the framework is the following. I'm not saying this is the best framework. I'm saying this is one that it's quite useful, and because it can solve different problems. So we have the input events. We will warp these events along some candidate point trajectories that depend on the application. So they are different for optical flow. They are different if you want to do 3D reconstruction. They are different if you want to do motion estimation or segmentation. And from this volume of events, we will come up with an image-based representation. And then the next thing we do is that we measure how well is this image in terms of event alignment. How well do the events align along this candidate point trajectories that, as I said, depend on the application. And for that, we investigate different metrics, and we call them focus scores. In this case, this is just the variance. And then this is just the general framework. Then the goal is to tune the parameters of these trajectories. These are parametric trajectories. I try to optimize these parameters so that you maximize the focus. And you will be maximizing the event alignment. And these are trajectories are describing the motion that the edges describe on the image plane as they were triggering events. So this framework has different applications. One of them is 3D reconstruction, and you can clearly see the focusing effect here on the left. These are just different image of warp events, so this intermediate representation warping the events according to different depths. And on the right, you see the extracted semi-dense 3D reconstruction from these warped images. This can also be used, this focus maximization framework for motion segmentation, work with Timo here in Australia. So on the top left, you see the image from the standard camera. On the bottom left, the input events. And what we will show on the right are these warped image, motion compensated images with different colors for the different moving objects. So this is doing motion segmentation. And due to the very high speed capabilities of the sensor, we can even do a segmentation of a coin dropped in front of a fan. This is no challenge for a high-speed camera such as the event sensor. These focus loss functions, they enable unsupervised learning, and there is amazing work by University of Pennsylvania here, Costas, and also University of Maryland, Cornelia, I think it's in the audience. So these loss functions, they kind of work in the same way as you would have like this photoconsistency metric, right? So this is explored in these works. Basically, you will input events, you will pass the events through some network, and at the output, what you want to obtain is these sharp images, and in the middle, you will obtain the parameters of the motion that gives you those sharp images are precisely the motion of the edges on the image plane. So in this CBPR paper that we are presenting later this week, we investigate 22 focus loss functions, and here you can see some plots of them for optical flow. And the good thing is that they enable unsupervised learning for events, which is, I think, a very interesting avenue. Now we are moving always towards unsupervised learning with the standard images, and we will do the same with event cameras. So just to summarize, this framework that I show, I'm not saying it's the best, I'm saying it's the one that I'm very excited about, and it's one that it currently works quite well for different applications. It's simple because you just need to define point trajectories to achieve event alignment. It's effective because it can solve multiple problems, and it has some practical insights, is that we kind of connect event cameras to the topic, classic topic of shape from focus, and we kind of conclude that the best metrics are similar in both problems. They are, so the variance, the magnitude of the gradient, or the magnitude of the Laplacian, which are well-known and good metrics for focusing in classical images. So to finalize, we just want to point out some research challenges with event cameras, something that is yet to be done. We see lots of papers, lots of algorithms coming out, and it's good, but there are still lots to be done. One of those things is to quantify the trade-offs, such as latency and power consumption and accuracy. So we know that if we put more power into it, we will achieve higher accuracy and lower latency, but we don't want to burn so much power. There is also the topic of the contrast sensitivity and bandwidth. So if you decrease the contrast threshold by which you trigger the events, you will have many more events, you will saturate bandwidth, and maybe the processing capacity. And this is something that it may not be always good to do. So kind of it's also needed, and the sensor itself is an active sensor that you can tune the parameters, the biases of the sensor, and this is still quite difficult, and it's not done quite often, but I think we should be doing more often. Another challenge is to pair event cameras with dedicated hardware, and we'll have a second session about it. And also another challenge is learning with event cameras. It's not clear yet how to do it, how to exploit what we already know from standard images, from standard learning on images to event cameras, and how to do asynchronous inference to try to exploit the tools that we have. And I think there are many more things that we can discuss, but these are kind of the ones that we wanted to point out in this presentation. Thank you very much.